It is time for Farm Crime. Hi, my name's Morgan and I'm a duck, goose, cattle, and tree farmer here in northern Vermont. I also like to make videos and tell stories. And today I'm gonna be boiling some maple sap to make maple syrup. And I figured it would be a good time to tell you guys a story. And so let's get into it. And I feel like this is a very appropriate story to tell today because it's all about the single largest heist in Canadian history. You know, picture this, millions and millions of dollars of goods stolen over the span of about 18 months. Police absolutely baffled by the crime. And the stolen goods didn't involve cash or jewels or gold or artwork or anything like that. This was all about the theft of maple syrup.
I happen to know everything there is to know about maple syrup. I love maple syrup.
But this wasn't just any old theft of any old maple syrup. This was a theft of maple syrup owned by the maple syrup mafia.
You have any idea who you're stealing from?
Yes, you heard me right, the maple syrup mafia.
Waffles, what have I done to you to make you treat me so disrespectfully?
And technically, they're not really the mafia because this is all state sanctioned, but they are absolutely 100% a cartel. A group that's known in English as the Federation of Quebec Maple Syrup Producers, or more commonly referred to as FPAC. A lot of folks call them like the OPEC of maple syrup because they operate very similarly to OPEC, which is that global oil cartel that really drives the price of crude oil in the world. Much like OPEC, FPAC drives the price of maple syrup in the world. And let me just tell you guys, the price of maple syrup these days is sky high. Because Quebec produces roughly 70 to 80% of the world's global maple syrup supply, the global supply, not just for Canada, but the entire world, most of that syrup is coming from Quebec, just north of us here in Vermont. And so back in 2011 and 2012, FPAC had roughly 9,500 barrels of maple syrup stolen from them. And just to give you a sense of how much 9,500 barrels of maple syrup is, each barrel weighs about 600 pounds. And so 9,500 barrels is roughly the weight equivalent of 47 blue whales. I mean, that's just an absolutely staggering amount of maple syrup. And when you think about how much maple syrup is worth, it is even more mind-blowing. For example, a barrel of crude oil, in the last year or so, the price has fluctuated between $75 and $100. And so would you believe me if I were to tell you that the price of maple syrup is 10 times that? Well, you shouldn't believe me because the price of maple syrup in Canada right now trades at roughly $2,000 per barrel. So some of you folks might be hearing this story and saying, oh, this is kind of funny. He's talking about Canadians getting ripped off for maple syrup. But when you think about dollar amounts in that level, it really is a serious crime. And I mean, this was the largest theft of maple syrup in human history, and it was the largest theft of anything at all in Canada, in Canadian history at the time.
But when I first heard of this story, the question that was triggered for me was, how does any organization at all have that much maple syrup on hand?
And well, the answer to that question is, that's basically just how the maple syrup cartel works. So for those of you guys who are not familiar, a cartel is when a group of businesses work together to control pricing, distribution, even product selection across a single industry. You know, so there are illegal drug cartels, there's also things like OPEC, and then in Canada specifically, there is FPAC, which is a cartel that operates in Quebec, and they are state sanctioned. Cartels are usually illegal because they drive up prices and give the consumer kind of a raw deal, but through some weird quirks of Canadian and provincial law, there is a cartel that controls the distribution of all maple syrup produced in mass quantity in the province of Quebec. And that very much is a situation that's unique to Canada. And because by law, the fact that FPAC controls all maple syrup production in Quebec, and because Quebec is responsible for about 70 to 80% of the world's maple syrup production, that basically means FPAC is able to set and control the world's pricing with an iron fist. And the way that FPAC does this is because they have these warehouses in a strategic reserve of maple syrup. You know, a lot of countries have strategic reserves of oil. Like here in the United States, we have that. The government holds on to a large quantity of barrels of oil. As prices start to fluctuate, they're able to take those reserves and release them into the marketplace and either raise or lower prices by having the ability to adjust the availability of supply. And particularly for a product like maple syrup, that's an important mechanism because the production of maple syrup is highly weather dependent.
And why are maple syrup prices so weather dependent? Well, it's because maple syrup comes from maple trees. So you see, maple sap will run up and down the tree trunk of a certain type of maple tree when you have weather that is freezing at night and then above freezing during the day. It was first really perfected by the native peoples of northern United States and southern Canada. Doesn't look like we have much in this bucket today. The natives shared that information with the white settlers from Europe, and particularly in places like Quebec and Vermont, the gathering of maple sap and the production of maple syrup, it became a core cultural tradition. And the production process is fascinating. So like I said, we had freezing temps overnight. It's about, I don't know, 20 degrees Fahrenheit here right now on the farm at about 9:30 in the morning. The high today is expected to get up to about 40, which is perfect sap collection weather. And you can even see here some of the sap from last night. Like if you look really closely at this tap right here, you can see somewhere overnight, the sap that was dripping out of the tap froze. And I've got a whole bunch of frozen sap in the bottom of this bucket. And now your weather temperatures are going to dictate exactly how much sap you get on a given day or month or season. And it takes an insane amount of sap to produce maple syrup.
Here we go. Got another frozen drip.
Depending on the tree species, as well as the weather conditions, as well as the snowpack on the ground, soil conditions, it will take anywhere between 40 gallons of sap or 50 gallons of sap to produce 1 gallon of maple syrup. That, along with market manipulation from FPAC, is why a barrel of maple syrup is so expensive. And because the weather is also going to impact how much sap you get out of your trees, that means from year to year, you can have a massive difference between how many gallons of sap as well as syrup you're producing. And because most of maple syrup production is concentrated in one specific region of the world, that means that the weather pattern for that part of the world is going to dictate whether or not it's a good year or bad year for maple syrup. And because of supply fluctuations that happen from year to year, the price of maple syrup used to also be wildly volatile until around the 1990s and into the early 2000s when FPAC took control. And then as you look at the years following that, the price of maple syrup actually stabilized significantly. And by stabilized significantly, I meant like it was like a constantly upward going price trend. And the other important shift that happened in the late 90s and into the 2000s is most maple syrup producers changed how they produce their maple syrup. It used to be they would go old school like I do with the buckets. And because we're only really doing maple syrup on our farm at a hobbyist scale, like enough to supply my wife and me with our syrup needs for the year, as well as have gifts for friends and family, it's fine. But if you want to really be in commercial maple syrup production, you actually need to do something where you have little plastic lines and tubes that run from tree to tree. So that way you don't have to go from bucket to bucket to bucket to collect, which is exactly what you're seeing me do right now. You can just have these plastic lines that run through your sugar bush or cluster of maple trees. People usually call them sugar bush. And you can just have a couple of specific collection points that you can grab all your sap with a tractor and load it all up before you go to evaporate it. And now with that major advantage of using the tube system instead of the bucket system, maple syrup producers were able to produce more and scale their operation up without having to hire a whole bunch of labor. Like if you look at maple syrup and how it's produced now versus say the 1960s, the way I'm doing it is not all that different, but the way that they do it in most modern commercial operations is significantly different, and it's because of the fact that it's easier to scale up. So despite the fact that it's gotten significantly more expensive to buy maple syrup, it's also gotten significantly easier to produce maple syrup. Because alongside easier collection, the boiling process has also become much, much more efficient. Yeah, did I mention that you have to boil the sap once you've collected it? That's actually where the syrup comes from. And now to FPAC's credit, ever since their rise to power, things have gotten generally much better for the maple syrup producers of Quebec. You see, because unlike us here in the United States, you can't just start selling maple syrup in Canada. It's a highly regulated product. And when FPAC rose to power, it meant that all maple syrup producers had to distribute through them. They were able to manage the production levels because they would set quotas. They would also set fixed pricing. And they started to develop that strategic reserve of maple syrup. And that helped them manage the ups and downs
based on weather conditions and market demands. So again, that would generally be seen as a good thing for the maple syrup producers. But then you have this battle between the Federation and freedom, because all sap in maple trees in Quebec is essentially destined to either not be tapped or become essentially the product of FPAC. And I definitely could see how more freedom-minded folks would be rubbed the wrong way by a system like this. I mean, who are you to tell me how I can tap the trees that are here on my sugar bush? While most Canadians aren't nearly as libertarian-minded as Americans are, they can have their own independence streak, and I could see how that would rub some folks the wrong way. Because like I said, it is enforced by law that all maple syrup producers in Quebec have to work through FPAC. And as I was doing some research for this video, I really tried to look into this and understand how exactly that worked. And all I could find are crazy white papers and flow charts. But just believe me and the maple syrup lawyer that I talked to say that it is legal in Canada. And if you produce a quantity of sap and maple syrup in Quebec, you have to distribute through FPAC. And to maintain this system, FPAC actually really implemented a lot of heavy-handed tactics to do it.
Do it!
And that's not just my opinion, they even said it themselves.
Are there any actions you guys have taken against rebel producers that you regret?
Yes. Putting guards in sugar shacks.
You regret that?
Yeah.
For example, if a farmer broke the rules, the farmer would then be on the hook next year to pay for armed guards to show up and supervise the maple syrup production inside their own sugar shack. A sugar shack's just like a wooden building where people usually boil all their sap. And I could really see how something like that would piss a lot of farmers off. Hey dogs, let's go get some eggs, huh? The heavy-handed tactics of FPAC were definitely part of what stoked the fire of rebellion around maple syrup in Quebec. Because essentially what they were saying was that if you want to produce maple syrup in Quebec, you got to do it our way. And when somebody went outside their system, they would penalize them heavily. Probably one of Canada's most famous cases of maple syrup rebels prosecuted in Canada is the story of Annelie Grenier. Annelie is this like red-haired grandma type lady, and she and her husband had a sugar bush, and their plan was they wanted to be able to retire and happily make maple syrup as part of their retirement plans. But they did not like working within the constraints of FPAC, and so they began doing something known as barrel rolling, which pay attention to this term barrel rolling because it's gonna come up a lot in this story, where essentially they would produce maple syrup and then they would sell it outside of Quebec to smugglers so that it could be sold like here in Vermont or New Brunswick or Ontario or somewhere like that. Excuse me, can I look inside here? All right, no eggs. So Annelie and her husband were producing maple syrup in their sugar bush just outside of Quebec City. And so rather than go through FPAC, they started to go through these barrel rollers. And the main reason they cited was like freedom, and they didn't want to pay the 12 cents a pound that basically gets kicked back to FPAC as part of the commission for operating this maple syrup cartel. And so they ended up working outside the rules for a while. FPAC figured things out pretty quickly. And Ms. Grenier ended up getting charged with like almost $500,000 Canadian in fines, all because they were secretly smuggling their syrup out of Quebec and into New Brunswick. And they knew that they were breaking the law, but they felt like they were taking a stand and this was all about freedoms. And to hear her lawyer talk about it, it's definitely one of those cases where they see it as a principle that they're standing on. Because when you actually look at it from an economic perspective, it's usually in the best interest of the maple syrup producer to work through FPAC.
She wants to be able to trade without having all the red tape of this legal cartel.
But the law is the law, and the cartel has the power here, so the maple producers do have to kowtow, and that's what's led to a massive maple syrup rebellion in Canada. Oh yeah, now we're starting to get a boil come off this. And it really is through these circumstances that FPAC got the reputation as the maple syrup mafia, because much like the mafia, coercion is their primary tool for getting people to cooperate who don't want to cooperate. You don't like the price that FPAC is willing to pay you for your maple syrup?
You pay me.
You want to produce more maple syrup than your quota allows?
You pay me.
You want to sell your syrup to somebody who's willing to pay you twice as much?
You pay me.
Auditing people's sugar shacks, paying for armed security to watch over you, being told how much maple syrup you can produce and how much you can charge for it, all of those things are gonna rub a farmer the wrong way. And it was in this environment of friction between FPAC and the farmers that ultimately led to the big maple heist of 2012. So like I said earlier, FPAC has this massive warehouse, and inside these warehouses,
is where they store all the maple syrup reserves. And so picture sterile warehouses with thousands and thousands of barrels of maple syrup. And because maple syrup is pretty darn shelf stable, they can keep it there for a very long time. Well, when you have that much maple syrup, you also have a need to audit how much maple syrup you've got. And so a couple of times a year, FPAC will essentially send auditors in, and it's the job of those auditors to count all their barrels of maple syrup. And so basically you have these guys who have this really unglamorous job of just going into a warehouse and counting white barrels. And when they're doing this job, it's definitely mind-numbing and boring. But from my experience, it's always when you have those really boring jobs that when you have one of those interesting days, that means that either something went very right or very wrong. And back in July of 2012 for Michelle Gavreau, that's exactly what happened. You see, Michelle Gavreau, his job was to go into the warehouse, count all these barrels, and report out on how much syrup was actually in each warehouse. Make sure nothing got stolen, you know? And like I said earlier, a barrel of maple syrup is pretty heavy. It weighs around 600 pounds. And so as the auditors would be in the warehouse counting, they would usually climb up the barrels to get a better count. I mean, again, picture a big, gigantic warehouse with nothing but white barrels. Well, in July of 2012, Michelle was climbing a barrel and the barrel started to teeter and totter and he almost fell, like, I don't know, it was like 10, 12 feet or so. And it appeared to him that the barrel that he was climbing on was actually empty. And as he banged on it, it made a very hollow bunk and it turned out it was in fact empty. And then as Michelle investigated further, he found that many of the barrels were empty. And the higher ups over at FPAC totally freaked out. So FPAC brought all of their barrel counters to this one warehouse and they went through and counted every single barrel. And then all told, they discovered roughly 9,500 barrels of syrup were missing. Some of those barrels, like the one that Michelle was climbing on, were completely empty. Other ones of those barrels had actually had the syrup taken out and there was water put back in its place. And these water barrels were kind of dirty. And so they were easy to spot because, you know, you look at most of the warehouses of FPAC and they're like these meticulous, spotless, perfect places. And a lot of the barrels had like dirty water and the water was making some of the barrels rust and oxidize. And so you could kind of tell the difference between a water barrel and a syrup barrel pretty easy. And so FPAC got their arms around that one. But this now triggered the largest single criminal investigation in Canada's history because they needed to figure out who done it. At the time, the FPAC facilities had no security cameras, there wasn't like a key card system, and so the police had to cast a pretty darn wide net to find even potential suspects. And not to get all good fellows on you guys yet again, but this was essentially the Lufthansa heist of maple syrup. SQ, which actually stands for Sûreté du Québec. I don't speak French, and so I apologize for all of the pronunciations you're gonna hear in this video.
You stupid American.
And as the SQ really started to look into things, they came to the conclusion that this robbery was some sort of inside job and would have required both somebody with access to the warehouse, as well as somebody who had connections to the maple syrup smuggling networks of the barrel rollers. And this is the point in the story where I wanna introduce you guys to Avi Caron. Caron was somewhat of a shady figure. You know, he was actually the guy who owned the warehouse that FPAC rented the warehouse space from, where the theft took place. So he had a connection that way. I mean, I think on paper, his wife actually owned the warehouse, but for all intents and purposes, Avik owned the warehouse and he would have access to the warehouse. He was kind of a shady character. He had connections to the real mafia, or at least rumored to have those connections. And he'd also faced criminal issues in the past related to fraud and theft. And so I feel like for the purposes of this story, it's fair to say that he had a checkered past. And now Avik, he saw the fact that FPAC was keeping all of their maple syrup in his warehouse and he saw that it was unguarded and he saw that there was like no security to it. And so that got his criminal gears turning in his brain. But the problem is, okay, so you steal some barrels of maple syrup, what are you gonna actually do with it? I mean, you can't just take a giant 600 pound barrel of maple syrup to the grocery store and try to return it and get retail price for it.
Hello, I would like to return this.
And so Avik needed to make a connection with one of these barrel roller characters I was telling you about earlier. And that's where Richard Vallier becomes a character in our story. And Richard Vallier, he's a pretty interesting character for sure. He is a guy who
grew up in Quebec. He grew up around maple syrup, so the culture ran deep with him. But he was also a guy who really didn't like FPAC, and he had spent a lot of time working as a barrel roller smuggling syrup out of Quebec. And again, he was a maple syrup guy. His father owned a sugar bush and had been making maple syrup for years. He grew up in the industry, and so moving to maple syrup smuggling was very natural for this character, who is probably the closest in our story to being a Han Solo of maple syrup.
You've never heard of the Millennium Falcon? Should I have?
And so Valier and Caron, they were introduced to each other, and they set up this smuggling ring where, you know, slowly but surely they would steal barrels of maple syrup. They would take those barrels to Richard's father's maple syrup sugar shack, and they would empty the barrels out of their syrup, take the syrup and send it off to a smuggler who would bring it to New Brunswick or to Vermont or anywhere else. And then they would fill it up with pond water, with water from Richard's father's farm. And despite sounding very silly and simple as this whole scam was, it worked brilliantly. And they were doing this for months and months and months, starting in 2011, going all the way into 2012. And they didn't stop until they were discovered in July of 2012. And the fact of the matter is because they got lazy that they even got discovered in the first place, because somewhere along the line, they stopped filling all the barrels with water and they just would put the empty barrels back in the warehouse and hope that nobody would notice. And that led to our friend Michelle toppling over all those empty barrels. And now with SQ on the case and a massive amount of resources behind it, because they didn't want anybody stealing from FPAC, because I mean, heck, the maple syrup mafia is a huge driver in the economy of Quebec. The police began chasing down every lead and working the case more or less kind of in that textbook fashion that you always see about in the movies and true crime podcasts and the like.
I think I'm getting a clue. I've still got a raging clue.
They looked at every suspect, they chased down every lead, and very early on they were paying close attention to the barrel rollers, because I mean the barrel rollers were the most likely candidates to be taking the stolen maple syrup and reselling it. But the other clue that they were working off of was a more interesting one. You see, like I said earlier, the warehouses that FPAC maintained were immaculate, just rows and rows and rows of these pristine white barrels. And one of the clues that the cops noticed was that all of the stolen barrels seemed to be dinged up. And the reason for that was FPAC and their employees were moving the barrels with these special like forklift tongs that would pinch the barrels just in the right spot and it wouldn't leave a mark. It would leave those barrels looking pristine. But meanwhile, the barrels that had been smuggled out and then brought back in, they basically looked like somebody used a traditional set of forklift tongs to move them in and out and move them around. So the police used that information to check the records of all the local equipment rental companies in the area. And what they ultimately discovered was that there was this one guy, one person of interest, who was probably worth looking into a little bit more closely. And that's how the police found Sebastian Jutois. Now, Jutois was a really important character in this whole thing, but according to everything I've read, he wasn't really much of a mastermind criminal. He was really the truck driver more than anything else. And he was allegedly the guy who connected Caron with Valier. Valier, I keep screwing up the pronunciation, apologies again, not a Quebecois. And Jutois really was the connective tissue on this whole criminal mastermind plan, because he was the guy who Caron first talked to, who connected him to Valier and got him hooked into all the barrel rollers and all the smuggling. And it was specifically Jutois' job to go into the warehouse usually and use the forklift and grab the barrels and then bring them out. And so because of this forklift tip, once the cops got on to Jutois, they very quickly got onto Caron, and they very quickly got onto Valier, and they were able to map out everything.
Pepe Sylvia, I looked in the mail, with this whole box is Pepe Sylvia!
And that's really how this multi-million dollar theft ring began to fall. Now, as the news of this story broke, obviously it got a ton of international attention. I mean, you had this combination of a massive heist and a very unusual thing that was stolen. And so, yes, the press had a field day. I mean, documentaries have been made about this story. I mean, heck, here we are a decade later and you got puds like me making videos like this talking about it. This was a major story. And again, this was a major theft. Regardless of how you feel about the mafia-style tactics of FPAC and what they do and how they operate as a cartel, this was property stolen from them. In fact, the amount of syrup that was stolen from FPAC ended up amounting to 12% of their entire reserve. And from a dollars calculations perspective, 9,500 barrels of syrup at 2012 prices worked out to be about $4.3 million American. And even though the theft ring didn't quite acquire that much, folks like Valier have conceded that they netted roughly $7.9 million American from the theft and from the sale. And so the SQ was just all too happy to drop the hammer on the thieves. Now, once the authorities caught on to the fact that there was this theft ring that existed, they were able to figure things out pretty quickly, and all the major players were tried and ultimately convicted. In terms of consequences, what we have is Richard Valier, he actually ended up getting an 8-year prison sentence and a fine of roughly $10 million Canadian. Avik Caron, the warehouse owner, he ended up having to pay $1.2 million Canadian. Sebastian Jatois, the truck driver, ended up getting 8 months in prison. Raymond Valier, Richard's father, who owned the maple farm where they did a lot of their activity, he ended up getting 6 months in prison and had to pay a fine of $7,000. And then there were a few other players involved who ended up doing either jail time or having to pay fines as well. So even though they were able to rake in millions of dollars from the theft, they ultimately did have to pay some consequences.
Everything was for the taking. And now it's all over.
And now with the Syrup Gang punished or behind bars, I think that the only other postscript I have to offer you guys is related to FPAC. Because I think the one thing that the Great Maple Syrup Heist did was it brought even more attention, even globally, to what FPAC is doing, as well as the economics of maple syrup production. And I think some could argue that FPAC has been so successful in what they've done as a maple syrup cartel in terms of driving up the price of maple syrup that it's inspired many others to get into the market. Like, for example, here in Vermont, maple syrup production keeps increasing. In New Hampshire, that's the case. In upstate New York, that's the case. And really, if you look at the window that this story takes place, Quebec's maple syrup production and dominance in the global marketplace has actually shrunk. Like, they were fluctuating around 80% in the early 2000s and even to the 20-teens. But at this point, Quebec's hold on the marketplace has actually shrunk just slightly below 70%. And so that makes a difference. And with climate change making a shift on where the best maple syrup production can take place, and when you consider the fact that New England actually has 4 times as many tappable maple trees as Quebec does, you start to realize that the competition is no longer just within Quebec itself, it's becoming more global, and that maple syrup cartel has become so successful that it might just destroy itself. So I really hope you guys have enjoyed this latest episode of Farm Crimes. I will leave a playlist for more farm crimes if you want to watch those, or if you want to learn about how we make maple syrup here on the farm, I'll leave some playlists about maple syrup as well. Thanks for watching, everybody, and I will be back again very soon with yet another video.